he's basically been trying to master the art of being a bigger jerk to people.
No,
That's
and a
basically
book actually teaches you how to gracefully say no. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to another episode of The Self-Turn The List with myself, Dartey Obeying, with Maxwell Dankwa and Silas Bimpo.
Yep.
And funny thing is, this is our third attempt trying to record this episode. Well, not necessarily third attempt. So, we normally record on Tuesdays in the evening, but then I don't know what's happening. If it's formal for Nana or it's Mohammed's doom so. But then the lights, Silas didn't have, you said?
I said, Obey steady.
You remember the previous episode when they were talking about how come techno phones are so big in Africa because of load shedding? And Obey passed the comment and said he's glad he didn't mention Ghana. The irony.
I mean, it's such a business model for laptops, so it should be due.
You know, right? Anyway, so
Tuesday,
Salah didn't have lights, so we missed that session. Wednesday, Maxwell and I didn't have lights, so we couldn't record. Today, both of us, all three of us have lights. How you guys have a problem? I have a question. All three of us have lights, and we have been able to record. So welcome back to this episode. And I don't know, Silas, I don't know what's happening. On my WhatsApp status, I saw about four people post previous episodes talking about their podcast. I saw the status of this, but I couldn't respond because I've been quite some way this week. But then thank you guys for listening to us, and we really appreciate it. Anyway, so let me just, I'm talking too much, but then let me just start. I have a question. So
I turned off the YouTube comments. I don't know why you did that.
I turned off the YouTube comments.
Yeah, I realized that. I actually wanted to ask her, but a long time
ago. Oh. Then I'm being delayed. You know, I'm sure it's a genuine mistake. Yeah, let me work on that. Anyway, so you guys have an issue. So anytime I post something on my WhatsApp status, even in the Slack group, I realize it just happened. Whatever I have in my head is different from whatever I text. And when I'm reading after I text, I read the correct sentence or whatever I have in my head. But then later, somebody shows me that, oh, there's a mistake in what you've written. And I genuinely didn't see it. Not that I do not know it all. The correct thing is in my head, but I simply do not type it.
I strongly relate to that. But mine usually occurs when I take off my glasses. So, for instance, I think I was watching an NBA game. So, the Houston Rockets shooting guard James Harden. Harden spelled H-A-R-D-E-N. Mm-hmm. And I tweeted, I think that game, he almost made a 50-point triple-double. So I tweeted James Harden, D-O-N. And people are pointing out to me, I still didn't notice my error just because, like...
Did you say James Harden?
Yeah,
dude, James that Harden, is wrong. Actually, that is wrong. So wrong.
Harden. I didn't realize, too. Someone actually pointed it out to me, and I actually had to put on my glasses to realize my mistake.
Mm-hmm. Well, so if you wear glasses,
I'm coming on. So all the comments on all the videos are off?
No, I noticed that with the recent updates. I don't know about that.
Okay,
now we are.
This is that with the Hack Club. You can check out the Hack Club.
Oh, okay, but then now we are at 125 subscribers. I don't know where they are coming from, but we thank them.
Hey, last time I wanted to like 89.
Then you move to 100 and 112 or so.
Yeah,
crazy.
That's quite exponential.
Anyway, but Max, did you what's the name? Do you experience what I'm talking about?
my mind running faster than my fingers, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Not really. No, I don't. I think it's not a normal thing. Mm-hmm. I dare say it's a defect. The two of you suffering from one form of defect or another.
No, sometimes I feel bad. Like I feel people will think that, oh, my boyfriend or something. But I genuinely
like
do
that's
not see
your
it.
Biggest worry.
Yeah, I mean, someone probably doesn't know you, they'll definitely think that.
Exactly. So because of that, anything I'm posting on this on a major social media platform where it goes to like the public, I read twice or sometimes three times before I post. But then on my WhatsApp status, I just because I know it's normally impulsive and stuff, I just post and later someone will be like, oh, there's a mistake here. I'm like, oh yeah, what this? So that's all these people I've seen. All these people I've seen it, that kind of thing. Anyway. Maxwell, what's up? What are we talking about?
Okay. In the last episode, if you've listened, probably noted that Obin was particularly concerned about the direction of text stories we discussed. And
that one was in the Slack group, or not in the episode.
No. You actually did mention that we are in Ghana, so we should be mindful of what we talk about in the previous episode. Listened. Do you listen to our episodes?
I edit it.
Wait, what? I'm
talking to Obi. Do you listen to our episodes?
I edit your
episodes.
I edit your episodes. So, yes.
How come that skipped you? Anyway.
So that's true.
We'll be taking a look at good. So we'll be taking a look at things from an African perspective. I think we've spoken about TikTok, Neuralink, and all these stuff, which are far removed from the African reality. So today we are looking at so many things within Africa, and if you are lucky, Ghana. So yeah, we're starting off with.
Maxwell, I have something I want to share. The Lord has touched my heart. Say amen.
Amen.
Good. We thank God for.
I in the spirit.
Yes, I'm in the spirit. I'm going to talk about a book, the book of life, a book that has given me a sense of direction. Maxwell, please unmute your audio. Okay, people are making noise in your back. All right. A book that has given me a sense of direction. And it's the book of life called Essentialism. And bro, I want Maxwell's actually what Maxwell's feedback on this. He'll kill me, but then anyway, so it's a book called Essentialism, and it's by Greg McKeown. And bro, this book has changed. Or bro, sis, whoever is listening to us, this book has changed how it has changed my course of life. It has made me really understand where I want to be. Not necessarily giving me pointers exactly, but then helping me choose and concentrate on things that I consider important, and letting go of things I do not consider important. And it's so amazing. And because of that, I don't know, most of you know that I have another podcast, which is not a serious podcast. I decided to stop it, concentrate fully on this, do it well, and stop a lot of things to concentrate basically on what I really, really want to do, which is research. And it's, I don't know why Maxwell is still, okay, Maxwell, let me just say, so I'm as usual recording via Zoom, and there's so much feedback in Maxwell's background, so it's off. Anyway, so Silas, and basically this book has changed my course of what am I even saying? Anyway,
you do everything give me.
But then Silas, have you been able to read it?
No, I haven't been able to read it, but then I've read a summary. So before I read any major book, I basically go to the Samuels to pick up like punches. Also, what the author is trying to communicate, and from the summary I read, it's very detailed in the sense that it makes you kind of like break down life into like your essentials. So hence the title, Essentialism. So basically, you're supposed to map out the things. Oh, Max, I think that's a bio to read. Yeah, I'm a lazy person.
So Maxwell just put in the comment section that is a bad way to read a book, Silas.
Can I defend myself? Let me defend myself. Like, especially with big books. Like, in this day in Israel, like, there's so much information to consume. Like, you spend a lot of time trying to read every possible book or every book you come across. Like, regardless of the merits that come across.
Silas is a very lazy guy. Let's call that.
Maxwell says again, next thing we know, he's championing audiobooks instead of paperback.
Maxwell, that's what, like, I have an Audible subscription. So
you listen to Audible? Okay, yeah, I actually don't. But is it not too boring and slow?
This is the current book I'm reading. Hey, this is the current book I'm listening to. Oh, I listen to it at 2x speed. So I'm listening to Civilization and it's Discontent by Sigmund Freud.
But then, do you prefer an e-book, an audiobook, or a paperback?
I actually don't have any particular. It depends on my mood at a particular time. Because there are days where, like, I just want to put on my headphones and then work or do something or house chore anything. And for those scenarios, I prefer Audible. And for those times where, like, I'm in bed and I don't exactly want to watch a movie or to entertain myself that way, I'll basically pick an ebook. So it actually varies.
Okay.
But I'll definitely pick Audible over like paperback.
Compared to me, I like paperback for the classic nature, the fact that it's OG and all that. And I also like ebooks for the convenience factor. On my iPad, I can read it whenever I want to, and I like.
Yeah.
Okay, Maxwell is back.
I mean, like no doubt about that.
Right. Don't compare.
I like
audiobooks.
What's the name? I like text primarily because I like the whole mental reading exercise when you read in your head, and your eye mind coordination and all that. After I do that, it gives me a sense of understanding of concepts. Like, for example, trying to, especially when the text is so, I don't know, there's, for the lack of a better word, pictorial, I've forgotten the imagery. There's so much imagery in the text. I really appreciate the exactly. And it helps
my imagination.
Audiobooks are like a podcast to me. Audiobooks is like listening to Joe Rogan, but Joe Rogan is like an audiobook on steroids.
Exactly. So the same way like I consume podcast content, like that's the same way I consume books, but like just I have much more focus for that because I listen to my podcast that either.
I think audiobooks should supplement as versus replace. And it's very dangerous if it is replacing entirely you reading like paperback. So I'm not with you on this one.
I mean, it all boils down to preference. But as I mentioned, it depends on my mood. But I give much more preference to an audiobook because if you're in a noisy environment, for me, like I find it very hard reading in noisy environment. So like if on the Trusky or on a bus or something of that sort, it will be very difficult to read an ebook or paperback. But putting on my headphones, like if you have noise cancelling headphones, it's even much better. You're able to block out the ambient noise from like actually messing up with the content you're consuming. So for someone like me, it works perfectly.
Okay, so back to the book. So it teaches you how to focus on the most important things in your life because everybody has a purpose on this earth, whether we like it or not, whether we are religious or not. And one way or the other, some people lose their focus and their impact by working on things for people. And oftentimes, because we do not want to lose relationships or certain friendships, we tend to shy away from saying no. And we often say yes and maybes. And instead, and you realize that most of us, it's not that we don't have potential, we haven't found our potential yet. It's just that we are busy working on things for other people, filling up the time that we need for self-reflection. And we do not do that. And we end up being swayed away from what our intended goal was. And we end up being not finding our vision, not finding our purpose on this earth. So the book is not really a self-help book, but it's more of a guide to how to say no. But it doesn't, let me not say it shows your purpose in life. It doesn't.
Do you know what, Silas, do you know why Obi is particularly excited by this book? Because he's basically been trying to master the art of being a bigger jerk to people.
No, and the book actually teaches you how to basically say no.
Because within the period I've known Obi has always been laying emphasis on the self as versus the collective group. He's like, if it doesn't benefit me, there's no chance in hell I'll pursue it. I always want to strike a deal where I get a cut or I obtain a certain benefit. So this is like gold to him. He's happy.
I mean, it's a very good book. It teaches you how to say no gracefully. It teaches you how to prioritize your time and your activities. Because the writer basically says that saying yes to something that will not help in the long run actually means you are saying no to something or to an activity or that some time that you can use investing into the future you envision for yourself. You understand? So the writer is basically saying that not all activities are important. Like, for example, let me give you a typical example. So I started reading this book last week. I think when I started, I told Silas about it. And just that Friday or Saturday, someone called. And she's older. She's like a mother to me. And she's like, oh, she's starting an organization and she needs me on board. And immediately the Essentialism book came in mind. Then I started putting two and two together and I gave her a very diplomatic answer, which meant no. But the good thing I did for her is that I went the next step. I went the extra mile. Not necessarily extra mile, but then I did an extra. Hey. No, not that. I went the extra, okay, I think the word is extra mile. I went the extra mile of suggesting someone who I know is good enough to work on that project for her. You understand? Mm-hmm. We work on that project for her. And the person actually has been working with her. I don't know. I didn't follow her because I removed myself from the equation. And for me, I really appreciate the book that it helped me to gracefully say no. And so that I don't sound like a jerk, but I do that more gracefully. And another thing too happened recently. I needed a document approved by a group of people. And the guy I was supposed to work on a document with, he was unreasonably delaying me. So normally what I'll do is that I'll rather put pressure on him to, to get the work done. But then opener was not minding me. So after like one or two messages, I just did the stuff myself and forwarded it to the next group. Then later he texts me saying that, how have I sent the work? I told him that, I didn't get any feedback. But then I'm still open to his suggestions though, even though I've sent it for approval, that we'll try and see how best we can and was any factor out the submissions into it. Then even all that he said, all the things he said, Krasef, it was a minor part of the work I'd already submitted. So that means the work eventually got done and I was able to achieve my goal without really wasting my time. And that's also another thing I learned from the book. Like the book is really, really good. We should look at it. Maxwell, is the situation at your place better?
Yeah. Sorry, kid.
So
yeah, eyeballs. Yeah. So everything
so,
is
so let's, all right, so let's move on to what we were discussing.
Okay, I think Obin has really thrown up everything that we intended to discuss up into the air and scattered. So let's segue into a very interesting topic called digital minimalism. Sorry?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we're talking about, before we talk about the few news items, let's talk about digital minimalism. So basically, this is a concept that says that you have to be intentional about your usage of the internet as versus just going with what is trendy. So I watched a video on YouTube where one guy called Carl Newport was talking about how we should consider all the apps we use on our phones or on our laptops or PCs and think about how they serve a mm-hmm. particular use to us, then delete all of them, then install all of them per the need that arises. That way we optimize our lives.
I don't say Ghana data be expensive.
Forget about that data. I'm talking about the utility aspect. Do you think digital minimalist culture makes sense?
It does. It does.
Tell us.
I've been trying my best.
Again. The earpiece. Yeah.
It's waking up. No.
I've been eating. Okay, while you worked on it, Obi, you were saying.
Yeah. So I was saying that for me, it's important, and with the flooding of digital space with a lot of apps, softwares, and solutions when it comes to community and when it comes to communication, mm-hmm. you realize that if you do not take an active step in blocking certain distractions mm-hmm. or reducing the number of apps you mm-hmm. are using, we end up. It comes back to the whole minimalism thing I was talking about, the book on minimalism. We'll end up
essentialism or minimalism.
Being everywhere without doing essentialism. Sorry, yes, essentialism. Thank you. You realize that we'll end up doing a lot but not being productive. So we are just busybodies using all kinds of social media platforms without necessarily being productive in our everyday life. Mm. So for me, digital minimalism is very, very important. It's very, very important. And also too, it's, I don't know if it show, okay, I may be wrong to say it shows some level of maturity, because some very rich people use digital media a lot to promote what they are doing. So they will end up posting a lot. But then, don't be fooled. Most of these people have account yeah. managers and they don't do it themselves. So whilst you are there looking at what they are doing on social media, they are also what? Investing their time and doing some other things offline.
Yeah. Silas, I need your take. With the case made by Carl Newport, he was trying to say that when Mark Zuckerberg created Facebook, is it at Harvard or was it Harvard or Stanford? Which is which? Zuckerberg. Was he at Harvard or Stanford? I'm confused. Google it.
Harvard.
Okay. Harvard. So when Zuckerberg created Facebook in his dorm room in Harvard, the whole idea was to connect people. Then it got to a certain point where it became a business. It became about making all of us more addicted to it. That way, we can stay on the platform more and we can become products. Good. But then he said social media, this addictive phase of it has been tied into our society so much so that it's become a tool of social validation, such that when you take a pic, you have to post it as against creating an album for yourself. So there's this whole idea that you are living your life basically to the approval of other people. Do you think a minimalist culture would help?
For me,
that was for Silas, not you.
Approval of other people is...
Obi, you always have a lot to say. That was for Silas. Yes.
It's crappy.
Yes.
It's crappy.
Okay, Obi, fire.
Yeah, welcome. For me, I forgot what I was going to say. You see? What was the question again?
It's like social media becoming tools of societal validation.
Uh-huh, validation. So for me, it's a subjective opinion. Reason being, life in itself is all about validation, whether we like it or not. It's either about self-validation or family validation or societal validation. I'll put them into these three categories. These are my definition, not anyone else. And let me explain the three categories. So social validation is when you're looking at what people deem as success within your immediate society. For example, if you are in a society that a lot of people succeed with respect to music, realize that social validation will come about when you are let's say you become a successful musician. If it has to do with academic success, you realize that you don't want to be an academic to be successful. Family validation, which is close to social validation, but it's rather a close-niched kind of validation, is when you try to live according to what your immediate family, be it your extended or nuclear family, deems right or deems appropriate and to deems success. So you try to live up to that. And self-validation is when you actually look at yourself and look at what exactly you want to achieve. And personally, what you want to achieve, what really tickles you, and where you see yourself, that kind of thing. You try to live up to that. And a lot of people end up in these three categories. So you realize that people post on social media in the name of self-validation by saying that, okay, the whole posting thing. So they are posting because they feel good. And for example, by next week, we did some installations of 3D printers at the center. I'm going to post it on all my social media platforms that I've been able to assemble these number of printers alone. And this is what we are going to do, use these printers for. This is not really for others to validate who I am, but then it's to show myself, or it's to tell others that, oh, this is what I've been able to do. And here's why I say it's subjective. Someone reading it can say, oh, Akwarikori too, no. He just wants to give us pressure because everybody's posting that, oh, they are doing things. He also wants to post some. You get what I'm saying? So then it becomes subjective. If someone does something, it depends on your point of view at that moment. That's why a lot of men have vulgar lyrics in their rap, or vulgar rap lyrics, but no one really, or they don't really catch flag for that as compared to when a female artist, or to see the recent scandal with respect to Megan Thee Stallion and Cardi B's WAP release. Realize that a lot of people, the discussions weren't as deep as compared to, let's say, the baby or some other person's lyrics that carries a similar meaning, you understand? So for me, it's all about perspective when it comes to social pressure. It depends on whoever wants to think or talk about it. Yeah.
Okay, Silas, what do you think?
So, both of you are really, really salient points, but like in that simplest form, I think that word has been thrown about a lot in this day and age, validation and then minimalism and all that. So, like, we are trying to say,
and essentialism, perhaps.
Because right now, especially for the validation part, right now, social media has made it look like everyone has a perfect life, and then nothing wrong is going on for someone. So, like, for instance, where, like, recently, last week, when the Black Panther died, when Chadwick Boseman died, rest in peace. Early on the year, that was around February, late March, he posted a video supporting Black awareness, basically Black Lives Matter movement, in order to like raise funds for an organization. So that came as a result of the role he played in 42 as Jackie Robinson. Between the first Black man to play in the major league.
Yeah, baseball.
So, and based on his physique, people were of the opinion that probably he's losing weight for another role. So there's nothing really much to worry about. Others were also of the opinion that he's probably smoking. So There was this
crack.
Crack
me.
Panther. Yeah, crack panther. Yeah. I'm sure it's crack panther. I just thought that's physique. I mean, like, it's very serious. Like, you actually don't know why he is looking or how come he's looking the way he is right now. But I think people are just doing.
But did you see the actor that spoke about him on the set? You continue. I'll pull up the video.
Yeah. So people are passing various comments about him that like he's preparing for a new role. Others also said, "Oh, Chadwick is naturally slim, so there's no cause for alarm. He's perfectly fine. Only for him to die and actually get to that with the fact that he's been battling colon cancer for the past 4 years, from stage 3 to stage 5, and through." That time he took part in 4 major roles for 4 major movies. So was it 4 or 5? Yeah. So yeah. That's when we had Black Panther.
21 Bridges, The Five Bloods.
Yeah, The Five Bloods. Yeah. Okay, there's another one that is yet to release though on Netflix. Where
I'll put up the video.
Before Obin, you do that, I want Silas to conclude. I think he's making a very good point.
Okay, sure. My bad, yeah, darling.
Yeah. what's her name? I think Angela Davis or something. Pardon me for pronouncing her name wrong. But like, they're having such a partner. I think that would be her last movie. That would be his last movie he started. So you tend to realize that, like, things that we see on digital platforms don't really reflect our true selves. Hence, like, even with scenarios where you have people flaunting their wealth and all the, you tend to realize that it's actually not theirs, but something they probably borrowed from someone, and then they're just flaunting it for street credit. Street credit is a word that's passed around to a lot too. I mean, there's so much confusion than ever.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Finally, play your video.
Yes. Chadwick Boseman's co-star in tears as he reveals regrets at calling Black Panther actor precious amid cancer battle. So you guys should listen to this. And for me, it's very touching. And for me, I really respect this man for coming out and being honest about what he really thought inside. About his inner thoughts. Let me just play it.
And I'm thinking, you know, well, maybe the Black Panther thing went to his head. But now I have to, I regret even having those thoughts because they were really looking after him.
Nobody knew he had colon cancer. And of course, the way he was acting all the way through that, there was nothing.
You don't know.
You wouldn't have known. He didn't act tired or sick in any way.
Listen, we were in 104 degree weather running with equipment up to 40 pounds on our backs, going through these scenes. And that young man...
Oh, that's messed up.
I'm sorry.
Clark, it's completely understandable.
It's
you've spent so much time with him, and then when you didn't know, how were you to know about his behavior? You were not to know.
And your honesty, I mean, to be honest about what you said to your wife about him, when you didn't actually know and you weren't to know, and it would be understandable to have that view, but your honesty, it's so hard when things like this happen.
And I'm thinking.
So basically, I think this doesn't show the full thing, but then what I was talking about is that when they were on set, after every break, his girlfriend was around, he had a physical therapist, and had some other people who were around him. So like they were taking so much care of him and he didn't understand. He thought that, maybe because he has had a major role,
celebrity.
He was being pampered, exactly. Yeah. But then he didn't know was that they were actually taking care of him because his girlfriend was massaging his feet and all that. So you realize that it's
At this point, I can say Chadwick, they bore me. You're sick. Go get treatment. You're sick. Go get treatment. He still didn't want to act.
He knew it was terminal.
Yeah, I mean, like, as I said in a previous episode, most people who have, I mean, like, people I've come across who have cancer, they know that they don't have that much time. So
what, this is the bucket list thing for him or what?
Yeah, as in like based on my interaction with those people, so I'm assuming that probably like after all, you know that you won't last, like you won't be there in the next 5, 6, or 10 years. So you might as well use this time to do whatever you wanted to
achieve.
Yeah, I can understand that.
But I realized that for Chadwick, 2 years after he was, I'm sure when after he was diagnosed, I don't know, I'm not speaking from a fact, but then I
am sure he had a relapse.
No, not necessarily a relapse, but I'm sure after he was diagnosed of the ailment, that was when he had a change in mind and he had the whole epiphany of maybe this is going to be my way of making a difference before I somehow leave the earth. You get it. Then I'm sure that's how maybe he started working hard, and finally got the role in Black Panther, which actually propelled him and made him achieve his dream, because that movie has actually been a cultural reset with respect to how the West views Africa, with respect to how Black Americans view their cultural heritage as people who are formerly from Africa. And that's what
the kids, action figures and superheroes, finally a Black one. Yeah.
Exactly. So you realize that there are a lot of positive ripple actions that came from just that movie. And since he played a key role in it, it automatically puts him in a position of hope. So meaning, I feel it's actually God's plan that all this happened. Mm-hmm. For me, yeah. For me, and it goes back to the fact that he didn't want to not undergo treatment, but then he just wanted to fulfill his purpose before maybe leaving this earth. Because I think there's a quote going around, I don't know how true that, he said that if he dies someday, he wants to go to God without talent and wants to make sure he uses all that talent on earth before leaving, that kind of thing. Mm. You realize it. So you realize that
he wore his heart on his sleeves, basically.
Exactly.
Like, what's there to lose? Knowing that, like, because I have this YouTube channel that I love so much. It's called Yes Theory. So
Yeah,
life's like, knowing that, like, there's no tomorrow. So basically, anything that you do right now, do it with the mindset that you might die tomorrow. So why not do whatever you have to do right now? Like, take that flight, travel the world. Just tell that person
just be spontaneous.
You're mad at, like, I love you. Like, there's so many things.
But I'm proud of it.
Have you watched Chadwick Boseman and Larry King Q&A session?
No.
I mean, pull that up on YouTube. He says the worst advice he's gotten is YOLO. I'm sure it makes sense because he was sick. he actually spelled Bozeman. Why are you like this? Anyway, so while I'm being at it, so digital minimalism is a thing. Silas, do you use all the apps you have on your phone?
I sure
why
King.
Do you have him? Yeah, Larry King.
I don't see. Isn't this?
You just passed it.
What's the best piece of advice you ever got?
Learn when to say no.
Learn when to say no. Essentialism. Learn when to say no.
I'm not interested in your opinion.
Maxwell. Learn when to say no. You see. Let's go.
I'm just trying to imagine if the guy is actually sponsoring.
YOLO, you only live once.
Superpower you wish you had in real life.
I wish I could freeze time.
Freeze time. Stop.
Stop time and then move around and do stuff and then come back.
Okay, this is the template of
jump into a game now. If you only knew, I just throw some questions at you.
Okay. I'm nervous.
You nervous?
Yeah.
What was your funniest fan encounter?
A woman at the airport who had seen James Brown to get on up and wanted to challenge me to a dance.
Was that also the strangest?
No, I've had some really, really strange ones though.
Like?
Strange ones like you know, people showing up at places there's no way they could know my activities, but continuously showing up, like stalkers, essentially. Those are the most strange encounters.
Who was your childhood celebrity crush?
Childhood celebrity.
Did you have a childhood celebrity?
I don't know who that would be, actually.
Okay. Yeah. What's the best piece of advice you ever got?
Learn when to say no. Learn when to say no.
What's the worst piece of advice you ever got?
Agenda no go work.
Best compliment you ever got?
The best compliment I've ever gotten is that I usually listen to criticism.
Yeah. You take direction well.
Take direction, yeah.
What's the biggest perk of being a celebrity?
Free stuff.
Right. Someone else from yesteryear you'd like to portray?
Nobody. I should be done with it.
You know, it's never been done on film, Cyrus Attucks. Mm. The first guy killed in the revolution.
Christmas Attucks.
Black.
Yeah.
Never been a movie about him.
Yeah.
Guilty pleasure.
Baklava. Baklava is one of them.
What's a luxury you can't live without?
A luxury I can't live without. Jesus. Well, I feel like our internet obsession is sort of a luxury. Nobody can live without that. Nobody can live without that.
Nobody can live
without that. Yeah, yeah. So.
Is there an upcoming movie you're excited to see?
I'm excited to see Pacific Rim, actually.
Who?
Pacific Rim. Yeah. I'm excited to see John Boyega a little bit. Yeah. Yeah. He's my fellow actor. I want to see what he's going to do. Excited for him.
Well, this is a weird one. I've never seen. Longest period of time you've been awake?
probably 3 days.
Really?
Yeah, probably 3 days.
Superpower you wish you had in real life?
I wish I could freeze time.
Now this has a whole different meaning.
Freeze time.
Freeze time.
Stop.
Stop time and then move around and do stuff and then come back in.
You're stranded on a desert island. What 3 things do you bring with you?
You have to have a lighter. So you have to have some cutting. It's like a knife or some sort. God, hopefully I have some kind of radio so I can get off of it.
That's a good how to get off that.
Yeah.
Is there something you long believed to be true and found out wasn't?
I don't know about that.
Okay. And Chadwick Boseman in 10 years?
Hopefully I'm just happy. You know what I'm saying? Hopefully I've, you know, done everything with my...
This question hits him hard.
Why is spotty the sentiment?
That makes them happy and hopefully that they're the life, it's not about career, it's about life experiences that you've done the things
you
that
have
you
a
want
family?
To do. I don't have like wife and kids, but I have a huge family, cousins and my brothers, and
they're all close.
All close, yeah.
Watch.
I think he knew he was going to die.
Yeah.
How you answer?
This is 2018.
Yeah. How you answer the question, sir? Oh, Charlie.
Anyway, is this like a Chadwick Boseman Memorial Edition of STN or what?
Anyway, let's go back. Let's go back to. Anyway,
it was all to support the social agenda of the husband pushing in this.
Actually, it was Maxwell who suggested the video. Please don't pin this on
me. Yeah, surprisingly.
No, but you started this thing. Opening out the episode with your book, and you set the mood for this.
Guys, go and read this book. I mean, it has me.
Look at them blame themselves.
Me, but you know, I hardly change my mind. If I told you that, this has changed my life. Besides that, I hardly changed my mind.
I'm trying to get your attention here.
Sorry.
Do you know that every single time a person who is celebrated, so to speak, or a celebrity dies, we are all confronted with our mortality.
Exactly. And even when someone comes to you.
Yes.
It really hit me when Kobe died.
Because you're a basketball guy.
Yeah. I was like, Kobe's an immortal. Like, I literally immortalized like his image. Mm-hmm. In the sense that, like, when I was even told Kobe, that I was like, ah, this is pretty joke. How Kobe would be like.
Yeah.
So I was actually laughing about it. Like, I actually realized that it really hit me. Like, Kobe's actually dead. So
yeah.
When we had the memorial and everything, like, it keeps on ringing in my head. And
that happens because celebrities are this kind of very, in some cases, polarizing, in some cases, very unifying figures where we all can level with and share a certain emotion about. And that's because they are seen in movies, whatever field they find themselves in. For example, if you hear something has befallen Elon Musk, I'm sure his cult following would come mourning. All of us will feel a certain heaviness of the heart.
But I'm certain he'll die. He changed to something else. if he dies, he's a fraud.
but then think about how this all feeds into this essentialism and minimalist stuff. We spend most of our time trying to gain approval, trying to gain happiness through the acquisition of material stuff. And the internet has worsened it. Blind consumerist behavior. We're all being marketed to buy the next big gadget.
Bro. I said there was a chapter in
this. They won't make a finish any submission today.
continue.
So we are all being marketed to this fast lane about life. No one has the time to settle and be present in the moment and appreciate what matters. And we think that the internet has helped, which it has, but I think the usage and the way these tech platforms, social media platforms, have sort of carved out a certain niche or what they call a walled garden. That's when you get into, they want to contain you and make you a product and enjoy that place. The whole problem is.
I want to read a paragraph from this book.
Do you have a hard copy?
No, it's an ebook of, ask me how I got it. Anyway, so.
You didn't buy it, so yeah, sure.
I don't know. We don't know. Anyway, so.
This guy got Edward Snowden's permanent record a week after it was out. He didn't buy it.
Beyonce's Black is King and 90 came out. Anyway,
pirate.
It was on digital. Disney Plus. It was on Disney Plus. It came out that.
Okay, you have Disney Plus.
I don't know. Anyway, so there's this paragraph in the book that has to do with how you can gracefully say no and how you can actually try to, like, having certain mentalities in your head. And there's this short paragraph with the title, "Remind yourself that everyone is selling something." This is what it says about it. "It doesn't mean you have to be cynical about people. I don't mean to imply people shouldn't be trusted. I'm simply saying everyone is selling something, an idea, a viewpoint, an opinion in exchange for your time. Simply being aware of what is being sold always, simply be aware of what is being sold allows us to be more deliberate in deciding whether we want to buy it or not.
That is very true. That is very true. Almost as if unplugging yourself from this matrix where you can see things from a better angle, as versus always being in a position where you don't even know whether you have a choice or not.
Exactly. Back to why I like ebooks. You see, all that I did was the keyword Maxwell used was everyone is selling something. So I just searched for the word sell. I searched for the word sell in the ebook. Then it popped up a couple of pages with the word sell. Then I fast forwarded and went back.
Audible. You can bookmark a certain point in the audiobook.
Yeah.
Oh,
that's subscription fees. I don't know if it, but it's a previous description, that's right. And there's the transcript is there. So if you want to look for a particular thing, can just go to the transcript. Mm. I mean, there are paying tax to find whatever
you want to. So you see that, and one thing I've noticed that everyone, for me personally, some of us may not actually notice it, but for me, it's quite glaring. Everyone is coming to you with a proposition, with an opportunity, with let's do this, let's do that. But I have to look at, okay, will this help me eventually in 10 years, looking at where I want to see myself? Will this help me? So it helps me say yes to certain things. It helps me say no. And using this formula, I've realized that there's one particular person who I have constantly been saying yes to, and I haven't really regretted it. Even though I'm planning on saying no to one day, just to see how the person will feel, just for shaggy reasons. But then for me, all the opportunities the person brings up have actually helped me. And there's someone I'm actually practicing how to say no to in like a month or two's time. Anyway.
Must be a girl. Anyway, so talking about being able to identify opportunities and being able to cut down our usage of the internet and internet, do you know that now social media has become synonymous with the internet, but that is not the case? You can use the internet, but not use social media.
Yep.
I mean, have any of you thought of that? Like, use the internet and not use social media.
Yeah, the internet goes beyond social media.
Good, it goes beyond. But many people don't know that. In fact, a lot of people got to know the internet through social media. You remember when Facebook had this issue with net neutrality, when they wanted to make some sites free, but still within Facebook. And a lot of people came out to say that really defeats the net neutrality argument. To tell you that these platforms are trying to carve out a certain part of the internet where they'll provide almost everything and trick you into thinking that without them you can't really use the internet, and it's worked.
The truth is, whatever paid service you have on the internet, there's a free and equally good version, but I said I have to do more work to actually get things done with it. And whatever knowledge you pay for somewhere, it is free at another place. Like, for example,
you can get your ebooks for free.
Anyway, for example, let's say,
wow,
I don't know why he's attacking me. I don't know what he's talking about. Let's say a typical example is a woman was telling me that she paid about $149 for a course online. So the first time she mentioned it, I didn't really think twice about it. I'm like, I laughed. I laughed in my head, but I didn't really think much about it. Then I was like, okay. So later she told me that, she asked about this number of tests to do, and the passing grade is, I think, 50 or 70%. Then it hits me, that sounds more like edX. So I asked her, what platform are you using? She says a Harvard program, and she said edX. And I loved in edX scholarships, because edX actually has one of the most lenient scholarship schemes where they can waive 90% off the cost. And I'm even about taking a course. I've even started taking a course on innovation, And the actual course is by MIT, and the actual course is 40. The certificate is $49, and they waived it off. So I'm end up paying 10%, which is $4.9, which is like my food for like 2 days. If I'm to buy food for 2 days, that's the amount.
Your food for 2 days is hey.
I'm in Kumasi.
Oh
yeah,
I ask you for it today.
Yeah, I'm Kumasi, so things are cheaper, and also too. If I'll buy, it may be a lunch, two lunches or something. Anyway, so realize that everything can be got either cheap at a cheaper cost or for free. You just have to find time to search and research and try to know more about it. And there are always better solutions. I remember when I was going back to look at robotics research, I wanted to install ROS on my PC as a beginning of my... Of my process, but then after searching, I realized that to get ROS to actually run on the Windows was going to be too much work, and because of the other Windows softwares I was using, is there a plural for softwares now? Software now.
Still software.
Bro. It's still software. I think the Americans have money to add an S. Anyway,
unless it's possessive.
That's okay. So looking at the software I use, I've realized that I can't change to Linux just like that. So then I contacted Salas for a better alternative with respect to the Windows version. He also recommended VREP or Cordelia, which is actually a good simulation tool. And I've been using it and watching. I think I've watched about 2 hours worth of videos concerning how to use it. So subsequently, that's what I'll use to start.
Which Salas did you contact?
Bosom. The Oracle.
Oh, okay. Oh,
so the software is Coppelia Sim rather, and it was formerly called VREP. So you realize that there's always an alternative that will suit exactly what you want to do. Like for example, this podcast is being produced with a close to zero budget, thanks to us managing to make things work and putting resources and a lot of things together. So then. Yeah, I've lost my train of thought. Amen. Maxwell, please continue.
Amen.
Yeah, but Obi is making, I think, well-grounded points. The internet always has alternatives, but my issue is a lot of people even came to know the internet through social media, and it's quite difficult for them to imagine an internet without social media, and they are stuck in this. Yeah, and they are stuck in this whole space where they even feel that if they disconnect, they would suffer from the fear of missing out. And they feel that so much of their existence is tied to social media, and they end up having short attention span, suffering a cursory way of analyzing stuff, and they just become shallow. And that's one of the things social media does. Fast facts as versus in-depth analysis. You see it all over on social media. People don't really read into issues because they are inundated with information and they feel a need to gobble it all in within a short period. People are making shallow analysis.
Hey, quite people too are, wow.
People are using under the guise of woke culture. They are attacking people. Intolerance is happening on social media. So occasionally, I support disconnecting from it. Don't you guys agree? It seems all of you don't like to disconnect. Why don't you like to disconnect?
It's our human societal culture. Digital platforms, social media is a digital community, just like our physical communities where we do not like to disconnect from each other. We tend to not want to disconnect. Like, for example, what's going on currently in Ghana, I respect the whole award scheme. Dr. Yue.
Is it the Hugh guy?
I know. The Kofi Annan Award. So realize that it's funny, everybody's talking about this on social media to the extent that I've even managed to take the guy's picture and post it on my WhatsApp status to continue the conversation on WhatsApp. So realize that it's our human nature. We just want to be sociable and talk to each other.
And I very much agree because I got to know the internet actually through social media. So Green like
the perfect example of
Bruce. Yeah, but I actually don't fall. The fact is, I actually don't fall deep into the negative examples he gave. So like so I got introduced to internet through Facebook because I had cousins living outside the country.
What year did you join Facebook?
When did I join Facebook? 2011 or 2012.
Okay.
Yeah. Or was that about? Because my cousins, like, we used to be next door neighbors, but then they moved outside the country. So in order for me to maintain contact with them, I had to get on Facebook. So basically, that was how I got to know the internet. And being that young, I literally thought the internet was just social media. So I only knew of, social media and emails, actually.
Yeah.
So back then, it was yahoo.com and lots of Yahoo email accounts.
Yeah.
So basically, that was what I thought the internet was. But growing up, I tend to realize that it isn't exactly that. I was curious about tech, so that curiosity led to other things, and then made me explore other parts of the internet, like the dark web and all that. So that's why I tend to realize that. Yes. Yes.
So you know about the Silk Road, don't you?
We are not talking about it that way.
So you know about the Silk Road. I hit you up with some AK-47s. Okay.
No. Please, no one should message me or talk about it that way, please. I've already been sanctioned because
I'm in the dark way. The dark way, I'm going to call her too. Hey.
So then that curiosity led to other things, and then it made me realize that, like, the internet is bigger than what I initially thought it was. But then about the part where, like, people have shallow context or shallow understanding of topics, I can make the argument, like I said, on this podcast, I try to play the devil's advocate. There are scenarios where you can't exactly blame them because, like, as a society, the way knowledge has been passed on.
I've seen why.
Hey, okay.
I've been clicking. My videos have been made, the YouTube video. So we are having an issue with the comments on the videos that they were disabled. So it was because the videos have been made for kids. So that's why they send notifications, comments, and stories to be disabled. Thank you very much. We can continue.
I almost said I've lost my train of thought, but I haven't.
Smart. You haven't. You're not like me.
Yeah, so as I said, being the devil's advocate, you can't exactly blame them because due to the way knowledge has been passed in our society. But then I feel like with social media, it has been like the knowledge passage has become like exponential in the sense that the knowledge we tend to gain from other places are derived knowledge. So basically, like essentialism, the author basically got to find knowledge from somewhere. And then that somewhere got that knowledge from somewhere. So then there's an endless, like there's a long chain of knowledge passage. So as knowledge passes from one point to another, there's a sort of derivative. So
there's this theory that social media or increased usage or heightened usage of social media has an effect on our brain. And it's true. And it translates into a reduced ability to pay attention, and also this whole validation thing where a lot of people are under a certain kind of subtle compulsion to post their or sort of feed off reactions, or let's say feel better about themselves based on the reactions they get on, let's say, posts like retweets and likes and whatnot. This is very much a part of it. So you see a lot of people posting. And it even translates on Twitter, where you see people literally begging for followers. I follow back, kind of stuff. You see, people literally begging.
Someone did something that I really didn't like. So, you know, the Innovation Center, we have a community where we share opportunities with them through email. Then someone took a screenshot of an email we recently sent concerning an opportunity with respect to national service. And he took a screenshot of it and added our email address and posted it on Twitter. And I don't know why the person did that, because it's supposed to be an internal thing. Exactly. So it all boils down to the fact that some people actually want social clout. Well, some people may genuinely want to help others, but they should know your limits with which you you do your social good.
Yeah, okay. Obin just gave me the right term, clout chasing and all those things, and the inability to have sustain that attention. And all these things, since we are on the cusp of what we call the knowledge economy, where skills like coding, public speaking, project management, things that are centered on, let's say, our ability to think or use our cognitive powers are becoming more, you know, popular, or they are becoming the better jobs, so to speak. You know, I mean, it all goes in different directions, or it runs parallel of what the internet is doing for us, because people are using social media, they are being able to digest less because of the nature of social media, they are reading less, and so many things. Although it empowers, it's also sort of handicapped people in a certain way. Hence, I think there should be a certain metered usage of social media. And you even see it in these recent OSs. For example, Android has introduced digital well-being in their OS, where their focus is on how to remind users to cut down on their usage time. And I think Apple too has something like that. So all these things are features, and it's reflective of the reality. So social media and its and social media and its unrestrained usage has a negative impact, doesn't it?
I've just seen a joke.
Stop it. Silas, I beg you, continue.
I mean,
this what the joke says. Silas, please let me finish. So please, until you become rich, never criticize what people use their money for. Once upon a time, I said I prefer Samsung and Infinix to iPhone. When I started using iPhone, I realized poverty makes you think you are wise. This sub goes to Maxwell.
Are you sure? I mean, Maxwell has sat on both ends, has used both devices. So I don't know how it fits into that definition.
Me, it's...
Maxwell, would you like to defend yourself?
I put it on the doorstep of Maxwell.
I put it on the... Following Maxwell's touch about the fact that it has made us shallow. Yes, it has made us shallow. But then it's, I feel like it's something that comes as a result of information overload, because we have so much content to consume, such that in order for us to keep up, we sort of try to find summarized versions of stories and then try to use that to form our school of thought and then actually like live on it. For instance, like I tweeted, I think I shared in the Slack group where like I made a tweet about, I mean, Deborah made a post of,
I saw that one. I think it went viral a bit.
For my small Twitter account, that it went viral. So like I said, like if you take a panoramic picture of the, if you take a panoramic picture, you could copy the text using
Yes. Salas became, Salas had his 15 minutes of fame on Twitter.
Cloud chasing Silas.
Oh yeah, like point out, it was more or less like, okay, I'm taking a break. I went on social media and that was the first thing I saw. And when I said like, I didn't really think much about it, I just, even with basketball, like I just teach.
Salas, how do you feel? How do you feel being famous on Twitter? How was it?
Yeah.
How did you feel?
It felt weird and good. Like
that's exactly the validation thing I was talking about. You are feeding off it. It's like a badge of honor for you, isn't it?
I like the fact that people thought that I was very smart. Like that I actually thought about it.
Couldn't get more shallow.
Oh yeah. And about the shallow patch. Now that's the point I'm getting to. So on a shallow part, people didn't consider like the thing I tweeted, like the tweet was put in a particular context, but then people put in their own stories and assumptions as to how the tweet should be structured. For instance, like the password limit, the character limit for a password.
So some people are attempting to counter your very
it's something I was very much aware of. Like, yeah. I mean, it's pretty standard knowledge. But I was more or less concerned about the text. And people are kind of like, ah, that won't exactly work. And I'm like, yeah, I know it won't work, but that wasn't my focus.
People wanted to correct you because you had gone viral. You know. Try to steal your thunder.
And let me understand how, like, people suffer, like celebrities and all that, like suffer, like, with how people interact with engage with their content.
Let me try and see if I can see some of the comments under this thing.
Everyone comes to your teach trying to see.
Every time I see Geek Silence, I want to tell people that this thing. I had a hand in this name being formed. Geek Silas.
I hope Silas hasn't pinned the tweet. Have you pinned the tweet?
No.
I mean, I have to search for it. I have seen it. Charlie.
Silas is not shallow like that.
Four quoted tweets.
How many likes?
You know, like, I think a Nigerian commented and I was like, okay, like, Jordi.
People. 102 retweets, so 201 likes.
For a small account of mine, that's
my boy.
Someone said it's Nebrofu Semidie. It's exceeded password character limit. It won't work. And the rest were actually. Oh, someone said you're a natural criminal. Wow.
Hey,
some also said that with Michael Jackson and Jeff. I think let me favorite. No, I'll favorite it. Let me give the person this.
Okay.
Oh, sorry, whoever it is. I'm sorry. So someone said wisdom won't kill you. Someone said the power of AI. Hey.
Now there's one comment about. I mean, and I came back to, like, explain.
Someone said, if you die, in a sense, kill you, bro.
facts.
No lies detected.
And to Maxwell's point, like, the clout was right.
A lady said, like, you are smart. I should give you smiling with smile.
Wow. Obin, Silas wants to make his point over. Obin is still reading. Obin, keep quiet. Silas,
please.
Yeah, so like Tomaso's words, like I very much agree. Like the initial intention behind the tweet was not for clout. Because I just saw something and just, I mean, in my opinion, that's how I view it, that like to if me share my opinion about a particular subject matter. And it so happened that my opinion actually like made
or resonated with others.
And they felt like, okay, they should reach it and like for their other followers. So that felt very good. So it might, if I have like a continuous flow of viral tweets, like my head would tear.
Yeah, exactly.
And I don't know. No one can exactly explain the feeling behind it because it feels good. Like the sort of
dopamine. That's a lot of dopamine.
I mean, then you realize that it tends to build into things like where your followers increase. So like the way right now we have Estate Twitter and Nungwa Twitter and all that, you tend to realize that
Ben Coin Twitter Tuesday.
Yes.
Charlie.
You tend to realize that these people have a particular subject matter they are interested in and it resonated with a huge number of people. Charlie, 15 CDs a day. And we also have relationship Twitter, single people like me.
Social justice Twitter. Social justice Twitter.
Yeah, social justice
Twitter. Feminist Twitter. Misogyny Twitter. Yeah.
Hey, there are so many Twitter communities. There's also tech Twitter as well.
Yeah.
And there's Niger.
Tech
Niger
Twitter is not
allowed. Twitter.
The things are important.
It is. Niger tech Twitter is very loud. Okay, so within my search, Twitter was trending like around last week as a result of some coding arguments that sprang up in the Nigerian community. I mean, tech Twitter is not that loud in Ghana Twitter, but it's very much loud on Nigeria Twitter.
Mm. Mm. I don't even know what we'll call this episode. We've spoken about so many things.
Yeah, spoken about a lot, man.
Talk about essentialism, digital minimalism, social media, blah, blah, blah.
Tribute session.
Yeah.
Anyway, all right, guys, so that's all the time we have for this episode of the Self-Taught Novice. So, Maxwell, what should they do?
The previous episode, I noticed you edited it in a such a way that you were in the middle of saying something and you cut yourself off. I mean, what is wrong with you? Like, what have you been doing in post? Like,
No, did I cut myself off?
The last episode. You cut yourself off in the end. You're about saying something, and you cut it off. I was listening, I was like, is this a glitch or you said that? I don't know about.
I should say Ashada.
No.
Maybe. I think the thing was maybe I wanted to connect two ideas. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Then one landed on a higher note as compared to the other. So it made it sound like a cut. Uh-huh. So probably that's why. Anyway, so guys, thank you so much for listening to this episode of the Self-Taught Novice. So myself, Dartey Obey, Maxwell Dankwa, and Bosom. So we thank you all, and we hope you enjoy our future episodes. See you in the next one. Goodbye.